Okay, we're at 12:05. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. Just a quick note, if we do experience any kind of technical issues, we'll be able to follow up with everybody over email. In the moment, we just started recording, and I guess we're ready to start our fabulous fourth installment of The Color of Our Future, featuring amazing Latinas from different parts of the country, different parts of the world, joining us today to talk about their experience working at NASA and how they're literally among the stars. Today, let's advance the slide. So that was our welcome. Today's agenda, we'll have, of course, brief remarks. We're gonna talk about a little bit, Dr. Jeffrey Ann Wilder, who's here joining us today, was gonna talk about briefly about the color of our future and what this initiative from NCWIT is about. Then we'll move on to our panelists. And then again, we'll have time towards the end to do Q&A. So have your questions ready. If you wanna start typing them in the chat, you're welcome to do so. So without further ado, I introduce to you Dr. Jeffrey Ann Wilder.
Thank you so much, Johnny. Welcome everyone. Thank you all so much for joining us. We started and I just started beaming because it reminded me of earlier in the year when we launched this series, and it was so empowering, it was so engaging, and it was awesome. And so I'm really excited that we're able to continue the conversation today. My role, as Johnny may have mentioned, I'm a senior research scientist at NCWIT, and I work directly with the K-12 Alliance to ensure that research and social science is directly embedded and infused in what we do. And Johnny and I have been working on the Color of Our Future initiative for almost a year now. So what I'd like to do really quickly before we jump into this exciting conversation and hear all the amazing things from these wonderful ladies here on the panel, just want to spend a moment telling you about a little bit more about NCWIT. I have already seen and is seeing in the chat some of our sort of NCWITers, our usual suspects, if you will, who are part of the conversation. But in the event there is someone on the meeting today on the webinar who may not be as familiar with NCWIT, let me spend a moment telling you more about who we are and what we do. So of course, our goal is very simple. Here at NCWIT, we aim to broaden the participation of women and girls in computing. And we've been doing just that since 2005. And we aim to broaden participation through a three-pronged approach as a way to improve awareness, knowledge, and of course, to motivate change. And we do that through convening, whether that's through our annual summit or this year with virtual, our Conversations for Change. And we also accomplish that through our four alliances that we work with as a way to connect folks from various areas to computing. And our four alliances are, of course, K-12. We have an academic alliance that interfaces with higher education, a workforce and entrepreneurial alliance, and then also an affinity alliance. The second piece of our three-prong approach is through equipping. NCWIT has literally hundreds of resources online that are available to anyone and everyone. They are free, they are research-based, grounded within social science. And we have all kinds of things from deep dive reports, white papers, fact sheets, stats, anything related to how various populations can get more women and girls in computing. And finally, we aim to unite. And the unification piece is connected to our programs, like Aspirations, obviously TECHNOLOchicas, our Modern Figures podcast, and other programs like Sit With Me. Johnny, would you mind advancing the slide? So a little bit more about this series. So I mentioned a moment ago, Johnny and I were brainstorming one day. It literally happened like that. We were brainstorming and talking about what we can do to leverage our existing programs that we have at NCWIT, and also to find a way to sort of house the myriad of things connected to underrepresented women and girls in computing. And we thought that the best way to do that would be to engage conversations, because that's really a part of what we do very well at NCWIT. We create a platform for discussion. And so we created the Color of Our Future conversation series, which really aim to examine very important and interrelated questions about broadening the participation of women and girls of color in computing. And we recognize that some of the barriers and challenges that women of color, women and girls of color face in computing are very similar, but at the same time, they're also very distinctive. And so we recognize that there are distinctive experiences that Black girls, Black women and girls face. There are very distinctive experiences for Latinx women and girls, and also for Native American women and girls. And so we launched this multi-part series in February of this year. February seems like 5 years ago, right? Given the way 2020 is going. But we launched this series in February of this year. February and March, we started with Black History Month. We ended in Women's History Month. And we explored a variety of key issues and solutions to really advance the experiences of women and girls across the tech ecosystem. So we had a K-12 discussion, we had a higher ed discussion, and we ended our series with a discussion around the corporate area and industry. Also in May, during our annual Conversations for Change, we revisited the Color of Our Future through one of our summit series and had another conversation around that. And so we're really excited again because it's been a while since we've had a chance to do a deeper dive. So that's more about the series. So I think we all know why we're here, but let's kind of peel back the layers a little bit to talk especially and look around why this is such a pressing need. So Latinx women in post-secondary computing education, we know in general, there is a vast underrepresentation of women in computing, but there is even more of a critical shortage of women of color earning computer degrees across the higher education space. And we think about Latinx women in particular. So here are the numbers, 2% of bachelor's degree earners in computer science. Degree earners were Latinx women, so just 2%. This was in 2018, which is pretty dismal numbers. And then just 1% of all doctoral degree earners in computer science were Latinx. We know we need to move the needle on those numbers, and we know that there is really a pressing need for change. And so a side note to that, the Kapoor Center put out a really compelling and powerful data brief connected to women of color in computing in general. And Empower just recently released more research around the experiences of underrepresented women of color in computing. So please be sure to check out both Empower and Kapoor Center as well and their data. I think we can, okay, one more to go. There we are. So again, the Color of Our Future really spans more than just this webinar series. It really is a way for us to look at how we can bridge the economic, social, political, and cultural gap for women and girls of color, both now and on into the future. And the Color of Our Future really is a broader organizational strategy at NCWIT that ensures that we are anchoring all of our programs, initiatives, resources, all that three-pronged strategy that I mentioned before, really aimed on focusing, increasing the meaningful participation of Black, Latinx, and Native American women to positively impact the future of computing. So I'm gonna turn it back over to Johnny, and she is going to jump into our panel.
Thank you so much for that, Jeffrey Ann. And I'll stop sharing my screen in just a second so you get to meet our panelists. But following up on what Jeffrey Ann mentioned, we know and we understand that having role models that look like you is extremely important when it comes to developing an identity as a computer scientist or as a scientist or as an engineer. And that's why we have our amazing TECHNOLOchicas, scientists, engineers, all of them who work at NASA with us today. Rosa Avalos Warren, she's a Human Spaceflight Mission Manager at NASA Goddard Space Flight. Margaret Dominguez, Optical Engineers, also at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. Just a quick note, Rosa and Margaret do not know each other. They're meeting today for the first time and they work in the same NASA center. And then Susana Harper Tapia, who's a Materials Flight Acceptance Standard Testing Manager at NASA White Sands Test Facility. Alma Stephanie Tapia, Materials Engineer and Materials and Process Branch at NASA Johnson Space Center. I'll stop sharing my screen so you can see, get to meet our panelists today. Thank you for joining us. You're not seeing double. Alma Stephanie and Susana are actually identical twins, both working at NASA. What are the odds of that? I'm gonna start with Rosa. Please introduce yourself.
Yes, hi everyone. I hope everyone is staying safe and healthy. Thank you so much, National Center for Women and Information Technology and TECHNOLOchicas for the opportunity to be a speaker today. As mentioned, my name is Rosa Avalos Warren. I'm a Human Spaceflight Mission Manager working at Goddard. I started working for NASA as a research student for NASA Langley and Virginia Tech back in 2009. Definitely have had the opportunity to work at NASA Johnson Space Center, NASA Wallops, and now NASA Goddard. And I am very excited to be a panelist today. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Rosa. Thanks for being with us. Margaret, since you're right there on the same center, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Thank you, Jenny. And like Rosa said, thank you for the opportunity. Thank you guys for inviting us and for making this possible and have the make the resources available to everybody that's out there and that's interested. And I have to say that Rosa and I don't know each other because Goddard has about 10,000 people on campus, So we're really large. All the various NASA centers are thousands of people. So we really don't get to run into people randomly. My husband works at NASA and I won't see him unless we plan to meet in a specific location as well. As you mentioned, Jenny, I'm an optical engineer. I have been working at NASA for full time now for about 6 years. And I was working before that as a student through my undergrad, master's, and PhD. So I've been, since then, I've been working now for almost 11 years. And it's been a wonderful opportunity. I'm working on a space telescope now that we're going to launch into space in a few years. So it's very exciting to be working there and to be here today talking to you guys.
Thank you. Alma Stephanie.
Hi, everybody. Like everyone has said, it's a privilege to be able to be with everybody today and be part of this panel. I'm a materials girl at the NASA Johnson Space Center. And what I get to do is help select, maintain, and then also do failure analysis for materials that are used on all sorts of projects related to human spaceflight. Some of my specialties in the past have been helping support failure analysis, being that detective to figure out what went wrong on the space shuttle, if there were any issues that we ever had to resolve. Then I specialized in spacesuits for years, where I got to support the production and the maintenance of our spacesuits on ISS and the development of new suits. And now more recently, I'm helping lead the oversight of our contractors and also within NASA for Gateway, which is going to be a new space station, but around the moon, where we're getting to help select the materials and get prepared to certify them to be able to build that new space station. So very exciting to get to be able to be part of such an amazing mission of exploring space.
Super exciting. Wow. Susana.
So first of all, again, thank you for having us, and I appreciate it very much. And also thank you for all the participants who are watching here. We're excited to have you guys. My name, again, is Susana Tapia Harper. I'm actually the manager of our Flight Acceptance Standard Test Group at NASA White Sands Test Facility. And if you don't want to know what that means, it means that we do testing for all of the different programs to make sure that we have safe materials that are being used. So we do testing to make sure that the air that the astronauts breathe inside the space station are safe. And then probably my favorite part is I'm a flammability engineer. So we at White Sands, we blow things up and we burn things so that we can tell them how to make sure not to have fires on the space station and the other vehicles. So it's a super fun job.
That sounds exciting. So everybody knows, we did include Ilse Alcantara and Diana Trujillo, both who also work at NASA and are TECHNOLOchicas, but they were unable to make it due to conflicting schedules. So let's dig right in. Our goal in this conversation series is to empower and advocate for the inclusion of more women of color in computing. So let's begin by having each panelist celebrate one program or initiative, either at your space center or your NASA center, or things that you do outside of NASA that serve as a change agent in broadening the participation of Latinx women in STEM fields. Go for it, Alma.
Okay, so we're very fortunate that NASA helps empower its employees to bring change to the organization. And one of the ways they do that is we have employee resource groups where we're able to collect as organizations and as employees to be able to bring change to our centers, for the employees, to our communities, and then beyond. And so I've had the privilege to be the president and then also participate in our Hispanic employee resource groups. And I know Rosa has also participated lots, and Susana and Ilse also, in some of those organizations before. And we've been able to do things like translate a lot of the content that we have in NASA that is maybe not reaching our Latinx community, whether it be something that is a resource for not just specific Latinxes in our generation, but also their families and their surround and support folks and their family to be able to have access to NASA content in Spanish. And so we've been able to partner with organizations like the Mexican Space Agency to be able to translate weekly, statuses and video pods on what's happening on ISS, and also even produce games like Loteria, but Space Loteria in Spanish, that then can be a resource that reaches out to our Latinx generations. And then making sure that we're putting women in those roles as role models to be able to be sharing that content as the deliverer of that information, helps provide examples of successful women, and especially in the Latinx community, that are being able to be part of these missions, and helps then bring other women to feel and know that they can also be part of our missions.
That's fantastic. Thank you for sharing that. Anybody else from our panelists wanna hear? Yes, Rosa.
Okay. Yes, definitely. I think NASA has great programs. And I think one of the programs that I would like to celebrate is definitely TECHNOLOchicas. I think having a community that is looking out for the strengths and the needs of Latinas is certainly necessary in our community and in our environment. And one of the quotes that really stays with me is, she can't be what she can't see. And it's applicable in different levels. We need diversity everywhere. And I think we all bring something to the table. And what better off than the efforts of TECHNOLOchicas?
Well, and we're so happy to have you as one of our amazing TECHNOLOchicas ambassadors. Susana or Margaret, any additional thoughts on this first question?
I think there are so many programs out there, right, that it's hard for us to sort of be able to pick everything, because I think all of us here, you know, in the panel share a deep passion for doing recruitment, for connecting with other Latinas and future scientists and engineers for NASA. I know that I am extremely concerned about what the future of our world will be if we don't have more future scientists and engineers. And in order to be able to do that, we need to recruit them today, right? Because we still have some time to do work, but then we still need people that are going to be working on, you know, following that. There's so many efforts. I mean, TECHNOLOchicas has been such a wonderful organization, providing us support to be able to go reach out to schools and museums. I collaborate with other programs. I'm a STEM advisory board member in a children's museum in Virginia. And similar to what Alma was saying, I've been able to work with them to make sure that we translate materials that the museum normally only has in English, to be able to make that available to the Hispanic community around them, which they see is very interested, but because of that language barrier is not able to engage. So, you know, Jenny, thank you so much for making this platform possible and for giving us, you know, another wonderful avenue to reach out and recruit and connect.
Certainly. And just for those of you who have joined recently, this will be recorded or is being recorded, and the recording itself will be available on our website. I will never forget the opportunity that I had, that thanks to Alma Stephanie and Susana, who put this together, we visited a local school in Houston and were able to speak directly with astronauts in the International Space Station at what's it called, a downlink, where students were able to interact with people in space. And to me, that was just like mind-blowing. And you could see light bulbs and inspiration and just curiosity in the eyes of those students who are like, that could be me floating in space right now. I'll move on to the next question. So you talked a little bit about initiatives that you are actually doing that support the Latinx community, but give us an example of an exciting either project, mission, or initiative that you've led or are a part of at NASA that highlights the importance of the Latinx voice in this field. Go for it, Alma.
So one of the things, one program that we actually got to do was a few years back, the White House had a White House engagement initiative for the Hispanic community. And at JSC, we were at Johnson Space Center, we were able to start a program that was an engagement campaign for our community. And so one of the things that we did was NASA has a Bring Your Kids to Work Day. And we said that as an organization, we wanted then to bring folks from the community in, not just limit it to our own kids, but also be able to bring in the community to be able to have firsthand access and be able then to come and see firsthand the work that we're doing at NASA. And so what we did is we started working with underserved schools where we had high numbers of Latin and minorities and Latinxes, minorities in general, and women. And we started to work with those schools to be able then to coordinate groups of those students that could come on site and be able then to have those students and those young women be exposed, and then making sure that we had a lot of role models as women that were leading those. And then we decided to expand that, and then also started doing that during our spring break, during the spring break for schools, where we had students come and shadow different Latinx women and Latinx men across the campus who were doing engineering work, where you'd get assigned a student that then would get to follow you around for that day and be exposed to what an engineer does at NASA. And I'm really proud to say that now some of those students, I have a young woman who shadowed me, who is now a full-time employee. I have another young woman who shadowed me, who now just participated in the High School Aerospace Scholar Program, which actually for any high school junior out there in Texas, that application deadline is tomorrow and you can apply. And now got to successfully participate and do that program. And another woman who shadowed me, who not ended up coming to NASA, but just started a career at Lockheed Martin. So it's wonderful to see how those types of experiences make a real difference. And every time that we're able to spend time with the community, and those of you that are watching this panel are reaching out with your questions and reaching back to us, that you can find pathways and the doors that will open different avenues of what you may want to do in the future.
Certainly, just like a perfect example of what encouragement and role models, you know, the power up that it has, you know, where you have all these students actually following in your footsteps. Anybody else would like to share a little bit more on our second question? I see Susana has her hand up.
So I'd like to answer your second question, but with a little bit of a different angle, actually. So I think as Latinos, both Latinas and the entire Latino community, we are excellent communicators. And I think that's part of our culture. When, you know, the cousin comes over, hey, let me come over. Come, I'm going to show you how to work on this car. We're going to do this together. You know, everybody's family, and we're good communicators. And I think that that's an asset that we bring to NASA and to the community. And that I want to tell everybody who's watching here, that's the talent that you have that you may not realize that you have, that you can really bring to whatever you decide to chase. Recently, if you guys saw the SpaceX launch, there was a lot of issues that my team got brought into. that there was concerns about flammability and materials for that launch. And I think because of the communication that I was able to bring, it wasn't that, hey, you guys have problems. Hey, let's get together as a team and talk about how can we resolve the problems, what kind of testing we can do to make sure that we're safe. And in the end, everything ended up coming out great. Everything got approved and it was a big success for everybody, for SpaceX, for NASA, and the amazing launch. And so again, I just wanna emphasize that that's something that you're bringing to the table from your culture, from your background, that is extremely important. And I wanna say that it's something that we are truly contributing to the community.
That's incredible. And definitely about, you know, your point about being great communicators, it's just in our blood, in our DNA. Rosa or Margaret, do you wanna add anything else?
Yeah,
you go ahead, Rosa.
So going along, you know, with what was mentioned, as a human spaceflight manager, I lead a team for the, you know, International Space Station missions, commercial crew program, Artemis, and also the upcoming human landing system. So this past summer, as it was mentioned earlier, you know, I led my team through a successful Demo 1, the first NASA commercial crewed flight, and the first time in nearly 10 years this country has launched humans into space from American soil. And so from pre-launch to splashdown, I was certainly short of breath, and I wanted both astronauts to land safe and healthy, and I could not relax until the missions came to a successful close. So I feel as, you know, here, all of us, we're, you know, all the panels here, we're representing Latinas, women, you know, and overall working mothers. And to me, you know, us also going through and leading a successful mission provides another example of a successful contribution by a Latinx.
Certainly, that's incredible. And Rosa, just quickly, you mentioned there is something happening. There's a launch happening in 2 days. Can you share a little?
Yeah, no worries. So it was actually, the launch has slipped to the right. It was supposed to happen this week, and now it's going to happen November 11th. So that's the current date that we're tracking for the Crew 1 mission. So after the Demo 2 mission, now we have Crew 1. So it's coming up pretty soon, and I definitely, you know, invite you all guys to watch it. And so it's going to be an exciting time.
Wonderful. And if you do have links that we can share with our community members, I'll be happy to pass those along. That way they can tune in for the live launch. Margaret.
I wanted to talk about one of the, you know, all of the gals here have mentioned so many opportunities that exist at NASA, and even, you know, NASA as a whole as an agency, and then as the various different centers, we sort of focus and offer different types of programs. At Goddard, during the summer for the past, I think almost 10 years, we have had the sister program, which is the Summer Institute in Science, Technology, and Engineering program. And this is a 1 week long program specifically targeting middle schoolers. And they come and they sort of live at NASA during the day for 1 week. It is completely paid for, so it's extremely competitive. They only accept about 25 different girls, and they come sort of, you know, from Monday through Friday from 9 to 5, and they sort of work for a week at NASA, and they attend various workshops, they follow engineers and scientists, they do different demos. I've given demonstrations and I've done workshops with these gals. So specifically targeting, again, middle school girls, so they can come to NASA, experience, you know, what it feels like to be coming to NASA every day and to be interacting with scientists and engineers, because that also is a wonderful way of getting you thinking, because science and engineering is not for everybody, right? There are so many wonderful professions that we have all across the board. I am one of four sisters, and we're all into different professions, right? And all of these other professions are extremely important. But what I think is really important when I focus on doing science and engineering recruitment is to show you that science and engineering is one of these options. And if you come to Goddard, you know, for 1 week, maybe you discover that being a scientist or engineer in the future is something you can do that otherwise you wouldn't have thought about. So the idea is, you know, just know that this is an option. Come and learn about this. Maybe it's something you can consider.
That's incredible. I know that there's somebody in the chat asking about the name of the program. You mentioned it's Sisters.
It's called Sister. So if you actually, if you type Google search NASA Sister Program, Summer Institute in Science, Technology, Engineering. As I mentioned before, it is extremely competitive. It takes place at Goddard during the summer. It didn't take place this year, of course, but it normally does in the June, July timeframe. And we have hundreds of students applying for all over the country. We have families that plan their vacation from California to come to Maryland for a week so that their kid can go to this. That's not possible for everybody, right? So, you know, if you have the flexibility, what we see a lot is if people have family members that are here, they can send their kid for a week and try to do that. Everything is paid for. You just apply. And once you're accepted, you just come on center every day for a week and get to experience that.
That's incredible. Do they do that outside of high school students? I want to apply.
it's only for middle school girls. So it's really, you know, targeting sort of early on to try to determine, you know, are you interested in this? Come and learn more about it.
Certainly, certainly. Exposure to these fields at an early age is extremely important, which kind of segues into our next questions about areas of opportunities across the ecosystem, whether it's K-12 through career. What are some of those areas of opportunities for meaningful and influential participation of Latinas in STEM? Alma, go ahead.
So I think folks have mentioned it, but this program to me, TECHNOLOchicas, is one of those programs that brings real meaningful interaction because you are getting to know so many different fields of technology through all of the different TECHNOLOchicas that are part of the TECHNOLOchicas program. You're getting introduced to such a huge variety of different careers and the ways that science, technology, math, engineering shows up at the end of school, not just the classes that you're taking, but also there are programs that I really encourage students to take advantage of today that are available in their communities. Now there are many, many schools that have robotics programs that are started at early ages, and then something as simple as science fairs that we've all gotten to participate on from a very, very early age. I think that participating in those types of programs that are available in your everyday education and taking the extra step to say, I raise my hand and I'm gonna take advantage of any after school programs. Those are the types of everyday programs that people should be leveraging and trying it out. A little bit of what Margaret said is, you know, engineering STEM may not be for everybody, but when you give yourself the opportunity to try out different types of clubs, different types of science fair projects, different types of venues, then you're able to try out those different areas and see what is your best fit.
Thank you, Alma Stephanie. I'm actually going to move to our last question. That way we can have time for our audience to ask their Q&A. I'm skipping through a couple. And you've talked about it, you've mentioned it, touched on it about the importance of mentorship, whether it's formal and informal, peer mentorship. Is mentorship important in the recruitment, retention, and advancement of Latinas in STEM? How do we build a culture of mentorship for Latinas, particularly for those who may be underrepresented in their programs or departments or specific areas of expertise?
I think it's hard because I think the answer to that question is reach out, ask questions. And sometimes that's really hard for us to do, right? Some of the barriers that we have to overcome, some of those we place there ourselves because we feel like we're not competent enough, we're not smart enough, we're not all these things that we're not enough, right? So a lot of the times, because we feel that way, I just feel like I can't approach this person. You know, they're going to think I'm a fool. And why am I approaching them? And I think the first thing that I continue to talk to people every time, you know, I'm approached is, you know, you're doing the right thing by just coming up, talking to me, asking a question. So obviously everybody that's here today attending this is already taking the first right step, just reaching out, getting to know somebody, hearing how they got there, and then asking, you know, do you have any suggestions? How have things changed? And what are the possible avenues? If I'm interested in doing what you're doing, how can I get there? So very, very important is just to push ourselves a little bit outside that comfort zone, reach out, ask questions, send emails, send a reminder email. Sometimes people, you know, I'm guilty of this. I'll get an email and I can't respond right away because I'm thinking I'm going to do that in the second something else happens and distracts me. Don't feel bad about reaching out again, sending another email, continue to reach out. That makes a huge difference. We need to have a community that where we help each other, but it only starts if you're reaching out to that community to begin with.
Yeah, I will add to that that you know every school that you guys are at, there's people who care and who are trying to connect you with options. So ask your counselors, ask your teachers, hey, I'm excited about science. What programs are out there? There's always, I mean, programs and even these type of online avenues for you to connect with people. And then I completely agree with what Margaret's saying is ask questions, approach people, you know? If you see somebody that you admire because they have, go ask them a question. Hey, you know what, how do you do? I'm still doing that. I mean, in my career, I'll see somebody that I admire and I say, you know what? I'm having trouble with this question, how to deal with it. I'm going to call them and ask them, you know, I admire your style. I'd like to get your advice. So don't be shy. I completely agree. Margaret has great advice there. And then connect with the people around you. I mean, even if you don't have your best friend astronaut next to you, your counselors, your teachers, they're gonna connect you with lots of options. And then programs like this, like TECHNOLOchicas, enroll, stay up to date with what's going on. It's going to get you connected with a lot of options.
So I'm going to add to that, that go sign up for TECHNOLOchicas if you haven't already, because that is a series that this is where you're getting role models that are working with you every day and you're getting exposed to a variety of them, but also be a role model. You don't have to wait till you have a career in science. When you are a student or somebody who likes, if you're a girl who likes science, a Latinx who likes science, you are already a role model to other students who wants to get involved in science, sharing whatever opportunities you've gotten to participate in that you're aware of with your friends, putting it on social media, letting them know how much you liked it, why you liked it. Those you are serving as a role model already to those around you. And then you can motivate others who may be interested, who didn't know they had that spark in them for STEM to want to be interested. And then as for those of us who are already in our careers, making ourselves available. The fact that I'm going to have a 15-minute conversation with a girl who reached out to me last week that said that she wants to study mechanical engineering, isn't interested in science, and just being able to give her my perspective on my career and what I've done. Making ourselves available, even when it's 5 minutes here, 15 minutes there, an hour here, is a way that you are providing mentorship to others. And then for those of us in our careers, mentorship never ends, right? I make it a habit that whenever I visit another NASA center, I ask to shadow a senior leader. I usually pick a perky Latin minority or woman that I want to see in a successful role and how she's able to be so successful and effective. And so I'm always looking for that mentorship opportunity. And sometimes we aren't going to have a woman in our path that is in front of us that is a role model. Find those men who are champions of women to also be those role models for you. I know that there are many, many science teachers that I had that were the ones, the high school teacher that kept me and my twin sister after school and told us, you guys are good at math and science, you guys need to consider engineering, took us down to the counselor to apply to scholarships and pointed us in the direction of our career. The college teacher who, when I was in grad school, sent me some of his old textbooks when I was struggling in grad school, so that I could get a better handle on the work that I was doing. There are so many women role models that we need. And then when you don't have those women role models in front of you, there are so many men who are going to also be there to champion you and push you in your area. And, you know, also look for sometimes the role models that you don't have day-to-day interactions with, but are role models to you. I was very, very lucky to be working at Johnson Space Center when Ellen Ochoa, the first Hispanic woman ever in space, became our center director. And to be able to see Latinx women in that role, both as an astronaut and then also as a leader of all of our workforce, was a huge motivation to be able to say, like was said already, if you can't see it, you can't be it. But if you can see it, you can be it. So look for those role models around you that you can learn from.
That's incredible. It's, you touched on so many things that, you know, like Jeffrey Ann mentioned earlier, all the work that we do is based on social science research. We have resources that talk about encouragement and the power of encouragement, which brings me to a point, and I'm gonna probably call out on my colleague, Erica, who I know is here, for her to share a link, but through our Aspirations in Computing High School Award, which applications are open now, they're closing on November 5th. If you're an educator, whether in high school or post-secondary, and you recognize and see talent in a student, you can recommend them and say, hey, there's this award that you should be applying for. So it speaks to the power of those change agents that we have around that can empower you, you know, and our students to really pursue something and to really explore what you see in them as a talent. So I'll ask Erica to drop the link to the Aspirations in Computing High School Award. And also for educators, if you are an educator, there is an award for you also as well. So check it out. There is a question on the chat about NASA specifically. Do they do, does NASA or your specific centers, do they do anything in particular in regards to recruitment of women or minority or women of color? Like what interest, you know, how did you gain interest in becoming a NASA employee and staying in this, in the roles that you have now?
If I may add one, and then I'm sure some of the other ladies have additional things to comment. I will say that for me, the key thing was getting involved in these is organizations that are aimed at Latinos. So I got involved in Mexican American engineers and scientists in college. And that was a way to kind of just connect with people. And then in one of those conferences that they held, that's when I had the opportunity to interface with people from NASA who were there supporting that conference. And actually I participated in a little competition, and I would have never thought that I was cut out to be at NASA. But after I presented my little science project that I had done for that competition, he said, we need people like you at NASA and you should consider applying. And that just opened my eyes. And so get involved with all the clubs and organizations, because they really, they open doors and give you opportunities.
Absolutely, Susana. Actually, 2 weeks ago, I participated in the Great Minds in STEM conference, which is the Hispanic, National Hispanic for Advancement Committee. And next week is the SHIP conference, the Society for the Hispanic Professional Engineers. I collaborate with the SWE conference, the Society of Women Engineers. There are so many professional organizations out there, right, that are targeted specifically for women, for Hispanic women, just Hispanics, you know, and sometimes just engineers in general, right? There's certainly organizations within my field specifically that are looking to recruit only optical engineers, right? So it depends. There are so many communities out there. Just reaching out, attending as a student. Because I was able to attend these conferences, I was able to volunteer at their career fair. So you're attending a conference, you know, as a student engineer, and then all of a sudden you can talk to recruiters from a lot of the major companies out there, one of them being NASA. So from the Great Minds in STEM conference, I wasn't able to attend that career fair for the one day. One of my colleagues said, you know, this girl is interested in optical engineering. Can she communicate with you? I was able to speak with her for like 45 minutes, like Alma said, 2 days ago, to tell her about, you know, my story and what she can do. And then yesterday there was a job posting that my supervisor sent out that sort of fits to what she wants to be doing. So then I was able to send that to her. She was able to apply yesterday. So, you know, these things are only happening again because you attend, because you reach out, and because we have to sort of break that comfort. And I understand, you know, we get nervous, insecure, and all these things, and it's a challenge every day. We overcome these barriers that we set there. Sometimes these barriers are set by other people, but some of them they're set by ourselves. So it's important that we break through all of them as best we can, and we're patient in the process.
That's incredible advice, Margaret. You know, one thing I like to say often is that NCWIT has a resource for that. Oh, we have a resource for that too. So with that said, I'm gonna share my screen again and I'm gonna call on my colleague, Jeffrey Ann, to talk a little bit about some of those resources that are related to encouragement and persistence and recruitment. And then we'll open it up to the audience for Q&A. So here we go, let me share my screen. All right.
And Johnny, you're right. We definitely have a resource for that. I wanted to just take a moment to lift up some of our newer resources around. First, I wanna say that we have resources really on pretty much anything, everything related to women and girls in computing. We have this focus around intersectionality. So we do have some resources that are more targeted in nature to certain alliances or content areas or to underrepresented groups, for instance. However, all of our resources do have that important and careful attention to looking at the diverse range of experiences and voices that we find in tech. I want to take a moment because I don't know if we've had a chance to even talk about this newest resource that was that Johnny and I collaborated on together, and it lifts up TECHNOLOchicas. And it is in the, Johnny, you're gonna have to help me remember, ACM is the acronym. If you could, do you remember what ACM stands for? I saw Wendy on and Tim and Sherry, someone can, yes. Say it again, Johnny, I'm sorry.
Association of Computing Machinery.
Machinery.
Yes.
So they have, thank you so much, Wendy. The Association of Computing Machinery, we wrote a feature related to, it is definitely an old fashioned name and certainly for me, a tongue twister. We wrote an article highlighting TECHNOLOchicas and how important it is to employ intersectional approaches as a way to ensure that computing is more inclusive. A few more here for folks just to lift up, top 10 ways to recruit underrepresented undergraduate students. There's a really great resource on how to diversify undergraduate computing programs, NCWIT 101. We have a resource devoted to intersectionality, like giving an overview of intersectionality, colorism bias. Also, our Modern Figures podcast, which is has been very, very popular and very, very successful. So there's tons of resources. These are not the only ones, but these are some really great resources if you're really interested in doing a deeper dive related to the experiences of underrepresented women and girls in computing.
Thank you so much, Jeffrey Ann. I'll stop sharing my screen and I will open it up to the audience. Please post your questions on the chat if you want to enable your video and ask your question. That's also an option. Please don't be shy. We have Susana, Alma, Rosa, and Margaret for another 8 minutes. So what is the program for junior students that Alma mentioned?
That is the High School Aerospace Scholar Program. And if you Google it, you'll be able to find it. The specific, there's different states who have different programs, but the Texas High School Aerospace Program, the application deadline is tomorrow for juniors. And what happens is that they do after school, basically on your own, online modules on exposing yourself, being exposed to different areas of science, technology, engineering and math. You get to do a team activity with other students. And then some of those teams and students are selected to come to NASA to spend a week to 2 weeks doing a mission where, let's say you're doing a mission to Artemis mission to the moon, where you have to work together and be able to successfully solve problems. And it is an amazing thing to sign up to do because it also then is a wonderful thing to put on your resume, especially if you're interested in NASA and applying when you are in college to internships. And then there was also, I'm gonna be sending you, Jenny, some information. There's gonna be some information sessions for college students for internships that are specifically targeted to minority serving institutions and minorities in general that are gonna be happening in November to be able to prepare students to apply for internships and pathway programs to start their careers at NASA.
something I wanted to mention to complement what Alma just said, specifically if you're not at the college level yet and you're interested in working at NASA, we have summer internships that are for high schoolers. So you can apply as early as 16 years old. They're paid internships. So you get to come to work at NASA, you make some money, you're on center for 6 weeks. I encourage you to go online, nasa.interns.gov. You can apply to all of the NASA centers, any location that you prefer. I believe that you can submit up to 15 different project applications. So you go on the website, you read the various programs that are looking for summer interns specifically, and you just submit your resume, you say why you're interested, and you can get selected and, you know, get started as a 16-year-old hanging out at NASA. A lot of the people that work in NASA started as a summer intern. You know, all of us, many of us we started as a summer intern, then we transitioned into one of the more formal internships that today is called Pathways, and then we transitioned to full-time employment. So it's very, very common. If you want to work at NASA, you know, start small, like a six-week-long summer internship. I know we didn't offer them, of course, this past summer, but keep that in mind. You can always start applying early and look up for those applications. They normally open in the as early as February. So go check out what's on there today. Remember, nasa.interns.gov.
And then for our younger folks out there, there's also a series of different space camp programs that our different centers have that people can participate in, and then helps kind of prime them and prepare them to be able to take advantage of those programs later on. And Jenny, we can share some of those links also too.
Yes, and also to prepare you and gear you up for NASA, if when you're in college, participating and then talking to your professors is very helpful, because even, you know, sometimes they have different research projects that they're doing for any type of, you know, engineering or in general, and just having that experience from a lab is so applicable, you know, for any internships or future jobs at NASA. So that's definitely something that I encourage everyone, you know, talking to your professors or even teachers to see if there are any other opportunities.
Excellent. We have two questions on the chat. What about older women that want to switch careers to NASA?
So USA Jobs is where you can apply. And actually, just last week on my Instagram, I was posting, because we had 4 to 6 positions that had just opened up that were specifically to hire folks that are already out in the work field in other areas. Margaret mentioned that she came in, that a lot of folks do come to NASA applying from a student standpoint and then do internships. I was not one of those. I was somebody who came in directly out of grad school and started my career at NASA because I was a critical hire and applied directly to a position. And so then those avenues do open up, and you can, if you're already in your career, transition to NASA if that's what you're interested in. But usajobs.gov is where you can find those positions, and then also keep in communication. Like what Margaret said, a position opened up in her area. She was able to forward it to a candidate she already knew about that may be interested, the same way that I did last week, reached out to my networks and let them know that there were positions opening up in my division if folks were interested in applying directly.
So here's a 2-for-1 question about opportunities for Latin women or Latinx women with degrees by universities from Latin America. Are there opportunities at NASA? And then the second question regarding the Aspirations in Computing Award outside of the USA. If you are in Puerto Rico, military base, or Guam, you can apply right now. Our Aspirations in Computing Award is open to folks in the United States and its territory. So, going back to the first question about opportunities for Latin women with degrees outside of the US.
I did my undergraduate degree in Mexico. I studied physics at Universidad de las Americas Puebla in Puebla, Mexico, where I was living and where my family still lives, where I'm going to be spending my Christmas and where I spend most of my holidays. So your university needs to be, and I forget exactly what the name is, but it needs to be registered within the Southern approved colleges so that your degree is valid outside of your country. Most of the major universities and a lot of the Latin American countries belong to these organizations. It's just something where they validate their degree, not only within your country, but with another country. So I applied as a summer intern when I was doing my undergraduate degree in Mexico. So it's completely, you know, it's definitely doable. You just need to be able to check that you do meet that requirement. And there's more information that you can find on the NASA website and at your university website as well. And even if you're not a US citizen, so in order for us to be able to become NASA civil servants, you must be a US citizen. But I mentioned before, Rosa and I work at NASA Goddard. At NASA Goddard, we're about 10,000 people. About one third of those people are civil servants and two thirds are contracting engineers or contracting officers. Contractors don't have to hire US citizens only. They can hire other non-US citizens. So these other contractors that are working at NASA with Rosa and myself that are six plus thousand individuals are working there and they don't have to be US citizens. They're sharing the same office spaces that we're sharing. They're sharing the same labs. But they just have a different process of the way that they hire individuals. Sometimes we actually hire some individuals through our contracting officers because the process can be a little bit more streamlined than if you go through the federal government process. They obviously are very thorough as well, but sometimes it can just be a little bit faster. And there are things that we cannot do on the federal government side. So there are lots of opportunities. It doesn't matter if, you know, if you were born in the US, your university doesn't have to be here and you don't have to be hired directly through USA Jobs. Now, those opportunities that I'm always talking about so that you become a civil servant, those do have to come through USA Jobs. The contracting partners, we have dozens and dozens of contracting partners through all of our NASA centers. So the best thing to do is to go on that specific website from that center and just look for that. Just do a Google search, you know, NASA Goddard contractors, and you'll have a list of dozens of contractors. You go directly to them and you can apply through their website.
Then you can work side by side with all the work that we're doing here at NASA. And I'll also add that NASA.intern.gov site, if you go there, there's actually a tab specifically for international opportunities for folks that are from international schools.
Well, that brings us to 1 minute past the hour. I want to thank you, Margaret, Alma, Rosa, Susana, for being with us today, for helping us close out Hispanic Heritage Month, for being part of this Color of Our Future conversation series. You know you'll be getting emails from me very soon bugging you to do more outreach. To all of you who joined us today and want to get in touch or involved with TECHNOLOchicas, please send an email to johnny@ncwit.org or technolochicas@ncwit.org. We will be sharing this recording on our website along with all the links that were provided either on the slide or that our panelists have to share. So thanks again for being with us today. Happy Hispanic Heritage Month and thanks for joining us.